Hello and welcome to another episode of Character History. This episode, I'd like to speak about a character that is pretty unknown to most people, and in all honesty, she is an interesting and cool character that should be more well known. So this episode, it's time to speak about the other daughter of Magneto, Polaris. And before you get your knickers in a twist, yes, I did read Axis, yes, I know what happened, but just be aware, I will be speaking further on this later on in the video, so just bear with me. Her origin is a tragic one that honestly is really sad to hear. Lorna was born to a loving family, however her father, Arnold, discovered that his wife had had an affair with another man. While flying, 3-year-old Lorna was so distraught by the sight of her parents fighting that she yelled at them to stop, which happened to be the same time that her powers manifested. She ripped the plane in two, her hair turning green, and sent the plane crashing to the ground, but in horrible consequences, she survived and her parents didn't. Drawn to the area by the magnetic pulse, Magneto discovered the young girl and ordered the mutant mastermind, a powerful telepath, to rewrite her memories and at least let her try to have a normal life. Lorna tried to adjust to normal life, dyeing her hair brown to avoid suspicion, to be never thought of as different or odd within a mutant-fearing society. Years later, however, when she was in her late teens, a mutant criminal named Mesmero used a genetic machine that would allow him to control all mutants in North America with latent powers. Lorna's powers had not manifested properly, so she was drawn to San Francisco to find Mesmero. She first appeared in X-Men number 49 back in 1968, where she was first met by Bobby Drake, a.k.a. Iceman. Bobby saved Lorna from oncoming traffic by putting ice beneath her feet and asked her to come to his apartment to recover. However, when she meets the X-Men for the first time, they discover her latent powers, so they decide to keep her safe and try to help, but would fail as Mesmero found and kidnapped her. He put her into a genetic simulator that kick-started her mutant powers. The X-Men saved her and defeated Mesmero, with him revealing that Magneto was behind the whole plan, and then told her the truth that he was in fact her father. So when she had her supposed father in a killing position, she hesitated on what to do, but was convinced by Iceman that he wasn't her real father, as her father died in a plane crash. She let him live, defeating him, but found at the same time that even if she had killed him, he was still an android. Lorna was later captured by Sentinels and sent to a mutant prison, but she was so annoyed at herself that she wasn't able to try and use her powers to defend herself. In this prison, she met Alex Summers, aka Havoc, the younger brother of Cyclops, and they got on quite well. Bolivar Trask, the creator of the Sentinels, used their relationship to his advantage and got Havoc to do what he said or Lorna would face the consequences. However, they were rescued by the X-Men and Lorna decided to join the X-Men, as she was sick of being the damsel in distress on the sidelines and convinced Havoc to join too, as they were getting quite close. Initially going by the codename of Magnetrix before getting rid of it, Lorna and Havoc were never really sent on the bigger missions as they were not fully able to control their powers. On another occasion, the X-Men met a group named the Promise, a group that came out of cryogenic sleep once every 10 years and were able to take control of Lorna and Havoc. While under control, Lorna was able to use her powers to fly, but they were both freed by a member of the Promise who believed that it was wrong taking control of the two of them. Later, Havoc left the X-Men after a fight with Iceman over Lorna, as Iceman felt jealous that Lorna wasn't attracted to him as he was the one that introduced her to the X-Men. Lorna went after Havoc, but ended up being mistaken by the Hulk as his former lover, and so they had to deal with that collision first. Havoc saved her and the two returned to the X-Men. Then, Lorna was able to show her full potential when the X-Men were kidnapped on Krakoa, and a new team was sent to rescue them. Lorna used her powers to disrupt Earth's magnetic forces and throw Krakoa into space. This was the time Iceman declared his affections for Lorna, but she rejected him to stay with Havoc and the two retired from the X-Men to live together. While they were retired, Lorna had her mind controlled by an alien Shi'ar agent named Devon Shikari, who dubbed her Polaris. Shikari also captured Havoc and took over his mind and used them both to turn against the X-Men and assassinate Xavier. However, with the combined effort of Storm and Xavier after a tough battle, Polaris and Havoc were free from control and allowed to go back to their normal lives. Now, they remained as civilians for a long time and only occasionally helped out the X-Men. Secretly, Havoc was trying to rejoin the X-Men. Lorna became possessed by a psionic being named Malice, who effortlessly blended with Lorna and they became a very powerful being. Malice was in charge of the Marauders for many months until the death of Mr. Sinister, when her power weakened and Lorna was able to call upon the X-Men for help. But they arrived too late. She was captured by a priestess from the Savage Land who stated that she was Lorna's sister. It was later revealed that it was the truth that Xaladan and Lorna were both from the same mother, but Xaladan was going to take her sister's powers away. This process also expelled Malice from the body, but also damaged Lorna mentally and physically. The X-Men made another attempt to save Lorna, but this was when her second mutation activated, growing in height, gaining super strength, and becoming invulnerable. Defeating Xaladan, she returned back to normal size. In the hope of trying to return to her normal life, she traveled to Muir Island It was revealed that her second stage of mutation amplified emotions around her, so giving her abilities was based on the people that surrounded her. The Shadow King, an enemy of the X-Men, exploited this and made Lorna his bridge between the astral plane and the human world. X-Factor, a government mutant group, joined forces with the X-Men to save Lorna. Using a psychic knife to the head from Psylocke, Lorna was freed from the Shadow King's control, and at this time, Xaladan was killed by Magneto, and therefore all of Lorna's powers returned to her. Now, X-Factor came a call in and asked Lorna to join the team, as she was seen as a very powerful weapon to wield against Magneto should he ever try to attack the United States. So she was recruited by Valerie Cooper, and while she was working with X-Factor, she reunited with Havoc, and they would become the leaders of the team. They would break up and get back together several times over their first tenure with an X-Factor, but it would constantly be on shaky ground as Lorna continued to grow more powerful as time went by, alarming some of her co-workers. In this time, Malice would once again try to take over Lorna's body, but she failed and was finally killed by Mr. Sinister. However, when Mystique and Sabretooth were allowed to join X-Factor, Lorna objected, being the only one who did, considering that they were evil and could turn on them at any time. And lo and behold, that is exactly what happened. Sabretooth almost killed the entire team by himself in an explosion, which Havoc got caught in, leading Lorna to believe that he was actually dead. She would then go and help the X-Men fight Apocalypse in Egypt, and also help her father hide the fact that his power had been reduced. The pair went on to Genosha, a nation that enslaved mutants. Magneto wanted Lorna's help to free those mutants and take down the evil governments that were in charge. So Lorna, being the person that she was, accepted, and along the way, she was trained by her father about how to better control her powers. But the moment she found out that he was only doing this to restore his own mutant gene, she opposed him, but obviously lost because of his greater ability. She returned to Genosha and stood against him, but this was all in vain. The Sentinels, giant robots that sought to destroy mutant kind, were set upon Genosha by the X-Men villain Cassandra Nova. Lorna was powerless to defeat them and had to watch as millions of mutants were wiped out. This greatly scarred Lorna psychologically, and so she returned to the X-Men darker and more violent, wanting nothing but revenge. Even her upcoming marriage to Havoc could not change her. It was when she killed some mutant-killing soldiers that Havoc had had enough, and he broke up with her before the wedding of one of her close friends. Which left Lorna absolutely broken. She went on a rampage, nearly killing Havoc and one of her close friends. Xavier set himself a personal mission by working with Lorna to get over the grief of watching these millions of mutants die. Xavier worked with her, and once the sessions were over, she returned to the X-Men, promising no more killing and no more murder. While on the team, Iceman confessed his love, and the two started a relationship, but it wasn't really true when they broke up. Havoc too tried to come back, as he had been dumped also, but she pushed him away. Of course, at this time, M-Day happened, which I explained in Scarlet Witch's character history. Lorna was one of the mutants who lost her powers, but couldn't admit it to the team as she felt that they would kick her off, and she felt horribly embarrassed. Of course, a situation arose where the team was in serious danger. Lorna almost died trying to save them all. She left with Havoc watching over her, but she was taken by Apocalypse and transformed into one of his four horsemen. While under his power, she gained the ability to absorb viruses and generate new ones. The plan was that she would create a new virus that would wipe out all but 10% of the world's population. The X-Men stopped them and discovered that it was Lorna that was the horseman known as Pestilence. Gambit and Sunfire tried to stop them from taking Lorna back, but they were defeated pretty brutally. Eventually, Lorna was able to resist enough for Apocalypse to lose control, and she was able to break free. Lorna went back to Apocalypse to try and gain some answers as to why he had specifically taken her, but she was stopped before she could reach him by Havoc and the X-Men. And strangely enough, Apocalypse, as a gift, although still not known why to this day, gave Lorna back her abilities, and we just kind of have to accept it like that because it's still not been explained why, and I don't think they ever will. It was then discovered that way back when Xavier sent his X-Men to Krakoa, there was another team that was unknown to the others, and one of their members survived, Vulcan. Vulcan now wanted revenge against the entire Shi'ar Empire, so Polaris, Havoc, and another X-Men team took it upon themselves to go and stop Vulcan before starting another war. While travelling through space, Havoc and Lorna got together again, because in the middle of a war, in the middle of all the fighting, they were so unsure of what was going on Earth, they just decided screw it, and they decided just to be together, and it was a nice relationship while in the comics. Of course, while travelling through space, Polaris' powers would only go stronger, such as saving the team from being almost destroyed by the broken Stargates, stopped the almost unstoppable Shi'ar agent Gladiator, and almost killed Vulcan by attacking his bloodstream. Deciding against killing him, she left him to Havoc, who also could have killed him, but decided against doing so. She sent half the team home against their wishes and sought to restore Lilandra, the rightful ruler of the Empire, to power. Lorna and Havoc became the Loon Leader of the Starjammers, an intergalactic team that sought to restore order across the stars. Lorna and the Starjammers were caught by the rebellion members of the Shi'ar Empire. So this is when the Kree became involved in the war, and again the Kree were trying to attack the Inhumans. So while under arrest, Polaris was heavily sedated as they were powerless to defend against her. Eventually, with the help of Lilandra, she freed them from their prison and they escaped to Kree space. Upon being freed, Polaris swore revenge against Vulcan, and she did get it in the end, but we'll get to that in a bit. Lorna wanted to find out why her friend Crystal, the Inhuman, was being married off to Ronan the Accuser. Crystal admitted to Lorna that she was starting to feel actual emotions for Ronan rather than just being her duty. So she accepted and stayed at the wedding, but during the wedding, the Shi'ar attacked and tried to kidnap Lilandra. Stopping the attempt, Lorna brought more of the Kree to her side and also got the unstoppable Gladiator to help her. Polaris and the Starjammers made an attempt to go back to the Empire homeworld, Chadralar. Unfortunately, Lilandra was killed in the political coup, and Polaris was so traumatized that she sent all of the Starjammers back to Earth along with herself. Coming back, Lorna and Havoc were asked to re-establish X-Factor after one of its members had been killed, so they led the team again. But this was when she learned exactly what happened to her original parents, which again made her mentally unstable. She snapped out of it, however, when a member of her own team, the female mutant Banshee, chose to end her own life and became the new Celtic goddess of war and death, Morrigan. Following this, Lorna and Havoc decided to finally go their separate ways. Havoc had been asked to join the Avengers, and Lorna would lead X-Factor from now on. In Marvel now, Lorna is still leading X-Factor with a brand new team and under sponsorship of Serval Industries. She was in charge of putting her own team together, and it consists of Gambit, Quicksilver, Danger, a cyborg living construct of the X-Men's Danger Room, Cypher, a mutant who can understand any language and is a fantastic strategist, Warlock, an emotion-feeling technological alien, Georgia Takei, the mutant daughter of a mutant-hating terrorist, and Quicksilver's daughter, Luna. Since the whole team had finally been established and the kinks had been worked out, the team had become stronger, and Lorna had become a very powerful leader. As the series went on, Lorna met with her half-sister Wanda, aka the Scarlet Witch. While they were out of town, they ran into some trouble and dealt with it, and afterwards, after having quite a lot to drink, Wanda stated that she would make an excellent Avenger and wanted her to be part of the Avengers Unity Squad, aka Uncanny Avengers. Although Lorna refused, Wanda revealed that Quicksilver had joined the team only to spy on her for the leader of the Unity Squad, Havoc. So catching up to current events, Axis has come and gone, and Polaris' team were heavily involved in their own problems during the crisis, namely involving Sentinels and hateful world leaders. As a result of the Red Skull sending a hate message across the entire world, people were showing their true feelings towards one another, including the President of the United States, who planned to unleash missiles upon other countries. X-Factor swept in, made the save, replacing the quote-unquote football with a bunch of Conan comics, making a cute little reference to what Barack Obama had said in the past. The football, quote-unquote, was in fact the missile, codes, and launchers. Taking the case back to the base, they then went to try and defuse the people attacking each other in the downtown Washington area, with Lorna even holding up the entire memorial pool in the air while the other teammates held off insane soldiers opening fire on the public. They all had mind prohibitors implanted in their heads, protecting them from the Red Skull's telepathy, until Gambit's got damaged and Polaris had to put him down for the count. They returned back to Serval Industries, where a powerful shield had been put up to protect themselves and stopping the President from getting a nuclear launcher. It came under attack by Sentinels. The team all banded together, defeating all of the Sentinels, but it took all of them to take him down, and that was when two inverted heroes came to the base, Sunfire and Longshot. They were there to retrieve the quote-unquote football. They fought them off as best they could, but it almost was too much for them, until Georgia finally suited up and took down Longshot, teaming up with the others to ward off Sunfire. As a result of the end of Axis, Sunfire joined the team. The series will come to an end soon, but it has been an excellent incarnation of the team, and I do hope we don't see the last of the new characters just in the final issue of the book, as they were pretty damn interesting. Polaris has been in contemporary culture with only a few short television appearances to her name, appearing in the classic X-Men cartoon for a short while, and then again in Wolverine and the X-Men. She is a character that has the danger of being called overpowered, but she is a really interesting individual who's overcome such tragic odds to get where she is today. I'm glad that the newest X-Factor book is worth buying, but it is a shame that it's being cancelled. I hope that the final few issues do well and hope to see her in the future within a bigger book, as she does definitely deserve it. Now, you may be thinking she's perhaps constantly put in a relationship point and then constantly heartbroken, and yes, there are points where I would agree with you on that, but I would argue that she's never defined by those relationships. She is only pushed further to gain more power or to either get over those relationships. She is a pretty solid character. She is strong, she's funny, she's serious at times, and she's a strong leader. And hopefully we get to see her in bigger books as the years go by, as, well, she's been tragically underused to what is a very interesting character. And obviously with the revelation that the Scarlet Witch and Polaris are no longer sisters, that would be pretty interesting to explore. So, who knows, whatever the future holds for Lorna Dane or Polaris, it will sure be interesting. So, that was Polaris and this episode of Character History. Thank you for joining me, and I shall see you soon. Until then, ta-ta, my friends. Hi there, it's JR here, the creator of the Superhero Podcast. I'd just like to say a quick thank you for the 233 subscribers that I have ever since I started this crazy channel back in May last year. And honestly, it's been a hell of a journey, and I've been really fun, and I've met loads of great people, learned a lot of stuff, chatted to a lot of cool people as well. And just to let you know, it's only going to get better from here. I mean, it's crazy. I never expected I get this many subscribers, but I'm really happy that I do, and I hope that you all enjoy the content. Remember, I always listen to the comments that you make, and I always try and add that to my videos, but hopefully this new year I'll bring in some cracking new content starting with this new video. So here we go. Enjoy. Thanks.